Hello everyone. Welcome to the lecture on exclusion, deprivation and stratification. Exclusion and inclusivity. This lecture is a part of your paper on media and margins. This lecture engages with the meaning of exclusion, deprivation and stratification. Here we will classify the meaning of exclusion, inclusion in the context of media. We'll discuss how media popularized with the practice of exclusion and inclusion with their different domain like public and civil society. Also, this lecture engages with the theoretical and empirical form of exclusion and inclusion of marginal sections in media. It will help to understand the role of media in exclusion with different category, caste, class, gender, and religion. Media and exclusion. Creating an informed public sphere, talking about justice or at least bringing about news in a non-biased way depends a lot on the way how media functions. Media and their selective role create the social and political cleavages in a stratified society. As Yoginder Sikand points, with the dominant ideology, the role of media is biased due to the practices of prejudices. The practices of prejudice in media entangle in the era of politics, gender, caste and market also. In Indian society, which is hierarchical in nature, media exclude the voice of margin. In atrocities cases, media gives the representation of Dalit in inclusion with exclusion mode. The language, texture and the space for news are the tools of exclusion. Inclusion with exclusion is a pre-planned manifesto in media. In the areas of caste, gender, religion, politics, and public sphere, media help to understand the role of agency in the society. In the name of media representation, multi-caste corporation MCC use their agency to hegemonize the liberating space, and in any society, the agency decides by the structure of that society. Michel Schultz in his book on 1997, The Sociology of News, says that it is almost unavoidable that many a times we get a report of a news without framing it. Here, framing essentially means the intentional act showing some information or part of a whole event based on the propagator's ideology. He argues that political and media instructions are so complexly mixed with each other that it is hard to separate them. The practices of ignorance are also part of exclusion and inclusion. The practices of ignorance have nexus with the prejudices. It is clear that ignorance has tendency to hide something which is against the ideological hegemony. In mass media, the practices of ignorance derive with the class notion and gender notion. The nexus of money, media and politics try to develop the fragmented erosion of the society. It is dangerous for democracy. It is clear that media is a large commercial agency in capitalism. Media creates a need and then consumers for itself, and this is the main reason for the rise of capitalism. Media has its own ideologies. Media normally ignores poorer and weaker section of any society for its own profit motives. Media ideology has a strong influence in our daily lives. Pisainath said that today media, money, religion and political nexus convert the freedom of press into the freedom of depress. It is clear that media is not free from caste and gender practices on one side and capitalism on the other side. Different shades of exclusion in media. It is almost impossible to escape the influential power of media today. It is omnipotence, that omnipresence is not only acknowledged, but the whole range of social phenomena is being theorized by scholars like Stick, Hayward and others as mediatization of society. The independent and overwhelming media, with its tentacles spread over other social institutions, has begun devouring the latter into its modus operandi. Taste and crazes, swings of electoral opinion, standards of personal behavior, moral qualities, fashions in clothing, nutrition, music, habits of speech, all have come popularly to be believed to be the subjects of mysterious manipulative operations on the part of the media. as pointed out by Curran and Wingate in 1987. The position of media is therefore not looked as free, autonomous, and independent from the context of competing social forces that determine the disposition and trajectory of media influence. Gender and media. Notions about femininity and masculinity have taken on a new dimension, yet we find them rooted in tradition. This is not to deny that before Indian media opened up to global, or rather Western ideas, the traditional notions about gender representations did not exist. But that even after global exposure and cascade of changes that it introduced, the present valuations about represented gender roles in media have not changed. For instance, a female character in advertisement still is associated with domestic activities, whereas a man relish her services. This form of operation with manufacturing consent derives through the ideological hegemony. Noam Chomsky, in his celebrated book Manufacturing Consent, A Political Economy of the Mass Media, says, "The mass media serve as a system for communicating messages and symbols to the general populace. It is their function to amuse, entertain, and inform, and to inculcate individuals with the values, beliefs, and codes of behavior that will integrate them into the institutional structures of the larger society. In a world of concentrated wealth and major conflicts of class interest, to fulfill this role requires systematic propaganda. In this way, the role of advertising industry in Indian context briefly explained the class, caste, and gender in consenting way. Venturing to almost any local or global market will show that we live in a sort of promotional culture where everything from electronics, clothes, toys, furniture to a myriad of food products are glamorized or shown affluently. Language, like other forms of representation, is a site of struggle. Some new words like sexy, bold, hot, and cool to denote a person, a sexuality very often pass into the language uncontested for. The vehement usages of these words in advertisements apparently produce enormous passion and emotional surge because they encode contested sensuous meanings. The pervasiveness of pleasurable words in media leads to think whether they encode any relation between representation and reality. If articulation of language on real condition is what is presented to us in the form of absolute true feeling experienced after using particular product, then the whole agenda of sexualization of advertisement looks to be on the shaky grounds. In this context, it has been realized that the form of exclusion carry a form of inclusion with their predefined notion. Due to this systematic projection, media has tendency to exclude Dalit women. In India, the debate on gender extremely black out the Dalit women and relate them as a women in a holistic framework. Dalit women are triply exploited on the basis of caste, class, and gender. So, the form of exclusion of Dalit women in media also based on caste, class, and gender also. With the critical inquiry of media, it is necessary to problematize the practices of exclusion with caste prejudices. The structural location itself provides the base of exclusion in India. Media, a role in atrocities cases, always bias and categorize the incident in an everyday phenomena. One can understand the space of news for Dalit-related issues and the systematic ignorance of that incident. They basically argue that these incidents are not occurring on the basis of caste. Let us look at caste exclusion closely, caste and media. In 1945, Dr. Ambedkar criticized the role of media and argued that the untouchables have no press. With these words, it is important to understand the role of media to exclude the Dalit community. In the domain of visible and invisible process, media control the voice of margins in a different way. From one perspective, there is an absence of adequate coverage of Dalit issues, and on the other, regardless of the possibility that there is sufficient scope, it is restricted to particular issues which are considered to replicate the generalization of Dalit as lesser human. Through this, one can understand that why media did cover the annual Chaitya Bhumi event in Nagpur. And media also did not cover the Ambedkar Jayanti celebrated by Dalits in different places. Why media did not cover the BAMCEF, BAMCEF annual function? A young Dalit proficient composes a letter to Rajdeep Sardesai on 31st October 2006 in which he doubted on media lack of care towards the Dalit with the setting of two critical episodes occurred in the Maharashtra, which were the brilliant celebration of change of Dalit to Buddhism at Nagpur and the Khairlanji killings. He pointed that while media covers the Hindu celebrations like Ganesh celebration, Durga Puja and Kumbh Melas with lime editorial, discourses and uncommon elements running for quite a long time, yet they absolutely disregard occasions celebrated by Dalits. He also posed the inquiry that if this is not media segregation in view of standing, what else is it? He ended the letter with words that despicably that Ambedkar said in 1945 stays valid till date. In his article In Search of a Dalit Journalist, B.N. Unnial concluded that in all the 30 years had worked as a journalist, I had never met a fellow journalist who was a Dalit. In his article, Y.C. Rao points out that how media is biased in the name of meritocracy. He mentions that there is not a single Dalit journalist from among 20.59 crore in any of the major media setups. He also added that mainstream media never give a decent space and coverage of Dalit perspective and issues. In the name of Brahminical meritocracy, they treat Dalit as devalued and question their thinking capacity. In a way of breaking fundamental work on the progressive surge of Indian daily newspaper industry, Robin Jeffrey contended, in over 10 years of concentrate Indian dialect daily papers, including 20 weeks of Go In, which I remained in 20 towns, went by many daily papers and talked with more than 250 individuals, I did not, so far as I probably am aware, met a Dalit writer working for a standard distribution, a great deal less a Dalit proofreader on proprietor. On this way, the exclusion of Dalit from the space of journalism protects the hegemony over the hideousness. The liberal Indian writers addressed this basic inquiry of Dalit portrayal with the verifiable casteist reaction covered up under the clothing of meritocracy. The following are some of their reactions cited in Robin's fundamental work, India's Newspaper Revolution. Balwant Shah, Senior Editor, Sandesh. We have not looked at that the presence of Dalit on the editorial side of the newspaper. We don't really bother what caste he, a journalist, is. We like to give opportunity to a deserving candidate. Jose Panachipuram, Malayala Manorama. We never treat them separately, but they are not in a very big position, of course. Jose T. Thomas, former news editor, Deepika. They are not present in the newsrooms. They are not present in press clubs. They are not present in journalism departments. Their issues are not reported or published in the dailies. The study pointed towards the role of meritocracy as a process of exclusion. Most of the editors, journalists belong to the upper caste. The examination has pointed towards the negligible non-attendance of Dalit, as well as the domination of one specific group, the Brahmins, in the Indian English dialect, national media. The non-attendance of Dalit-related issues in media not just mirrors the non-appearance or practically unimportant nearness of Dalit as expert columnist, additionally, Dalits as a group of potential buyers of media, caste atrocities and role of media. Maharashtra depicts the social organized biasness of the media about the Dalit issues. Daily paper DNA was the first to report the news. However, that was 8 days after the Babar tea, and this depicts the predominant press is heartless towards the Dalit issues. While some Hindi dialect daily papers conveyed the police understanding of good equity with no examination. Let us look at new piece about the event. Sarita Kaushik, on her revealing weight title Stop in the Name of Caste Fights that post Kherlanji unpleasantness, the late murder of a Dalit will be an eventual outcome of vote bank legislative issues over administrative issues about position. She contended that a Dalit woman in her youth was murdered because of her illicit and additional conjugal undertakings. Sarita advocates in her article the Brahminical Hindu perspective. This is a recorded reality and results into the low-level delineation of Dalits. Thus, this piece speaks to the condemnable relations of the Brahminical station-gendered belief systems that subordinates and persecute Dalit ladies. As Smita Patil broke down, this episode demonstrates the thought of sisterhood cannot be actualized in Indian social setting. This advances the Dalit women's activist stand, which addresses the epistemic need of non-Dalit men or ladies and Dalit men to ponder the social universes of Dalit ladies. In this manner, comprehension of Dalit ladies about their social area and space has been experiencing sort of a scholarly surge from non-Dalit men or ladies and Dalit men. Media and religion. Construction of the other. The 1980s and 1990s Hindu nationalist project is strongly linked to the mass media such as television. Media tries to promote religious nationalism. Stanley Tempia asserts that mass politics and mass religious fervor in many places now make efficacious and explosive use of communication media and high-tech devices. Aside from radio and films, followed by television, perhaps the most sensational recent development is the use of VCRs and audio cassettes, by means of which both villagers in remote rural areas and the unlettered in the cramped urban slums can hear messages and see visual images propagated by leaders and ideologues from metropolitan centers. In contemporary times, the Hindutva ideology simply reflects through the series of serials such as series of Ramayana and Mahabharata, Hanuman, Nagin and many more. These serials simply depict the Hindu culture, ideology and mythology to revive Hindu religion. There is a need to understand these series of serials deeply. These series are not simply for the audience or according to the taste of the viewers, but the great politics involved within it. It is important to notice that how media tries to politicize the religion. How media tries to influence the general population by reinforcing these Hindutva ideologies. The exclusion of Muslims in media is another type of blackout. The texture used by the media for Muslim is problematic. A staff reporter of a Hindi news daily in the capital says that he is asked to cover Muslim issues only when something goes wrong. In case of positive news, he is asked to drop that. The member of National Commission for Minorities, Dr. Dilip Padgaonkar, in projecting the image of Muslims of the country, says that the mainstream media is divided into two groups. One stereotypes the Muslim as fanatical and fundamentalist, while the other media devotes miles and miles of news space for Muslims like sensational Shah Rukh Khan and Sania Mirza, the magical musician A.R. Rahman, Pacers Pathan and Patel, the Bangas brother Aman and Ali Khan, and many such others. One is unable to understand the extent of contradiction, that how a community that is presented as fanatical and fundamentalist could always do exceptionally well in music, sports, entertainment and in education too, like President Dr. Kalam. It is clear that how media entertained the Muslim identity in a fundamentalist and fanatical way. Media has the tendency to develop the construction of the other with predefined agenda. Conclusion. Thus, at the end of this lecture, we can say that the role of media in a distorted manner projects the Brahminical consciousness as a responsibility of memory. It exactly diverts the issues of incident and perpetuates the one-dimensional news. As an ideological state apparatus, the role of media basically projects the ideology of dominant section in the society. In the practice of exclusion and inclusion, media develops a blur fact of democracy. The structural configuration of Indian society reflects in journalism as a Brahminical consciousness. I hope this asserts the necessity to raise the voice for reservation in media and private sector also. I hope you enjoyed the lecture. For more details, please read the module carefully and attempt the questions at the end. Thank you.